started an operation, but then the operation was, I would not say halted, but it was slowed down. So you see the absence of clarity in policy. Home Minister wants one policy. 10 Janpath says, no, this will be counterproductive. So go slow. So go slow started. He was slowed down. Once when I was talking to the Home Secretary, the Home Secretary himself said, Prakash, you come to my office, I'll show you what all problems we are having. So the Home Secretary, the Home Minister, they were all having problems because from the highest level, from the party's highest level, they were being restrained. This was the problem and the dilemma in the UPA. Now come to present NDA government. Now the NDA government has been in power now for nearly 11 months. Saal bhar hone ko aa raha hai. To date, they have not clarified what their policy is. They have not clarified. In one of my meetings with, okay, I should not be mentioning all this, but at the highest level, I said that you should come up with your policy. And I said that you should call a meeting of chief ministers of all the affected states, and that should be addressed by the Prime Minister, where the Prime Minister should give out his policy. But nothing like that has happened. And the only statements which the Home Minister has made from time to time is that there will be no talks with the Naxalites unless they give up violence. No, this is neither here nor there. Baat kariye ya nahi kariye, ye sawal nahi hai. Sawal ye hai ki aap kya karne ja rahe hain? What are you going to do? What is your policy? What is your direction to the security forces? What is your advice to the states? So even today, there is no clarity about the policy which is to be followed. Now, in the absence of clarity at Delhi, what is happening? There is a proverb in Hindi, apni apni dafli apna apna raag. So every chief minister is pursuing a different policy. Every chief minister has a different policy to deal with the Maoist problem. When you talk to Raman Singh, he's of course quite clear. He says, no, we have to undertake operations, and he gives full latitude to the security force. But when it comes to Bihar, Nitish Babu says, no, development model, it will succeed and we should undertake development. No, there is no problem with development, but how do you develop an area? You can develop an area only after you have established your authority there. When you don't have your authority there, then if you sort of undertake a development project, tomorrow it will be blown up by the Maoists. Schools are constructed, they are blown up by the Maoists. Thanas are built, thana buildings are constructed, that is blown up by the Maoists. Road construction, they do not allow. They do not allow road construction because they say road, once you have the roads, then the security forces will be here all over. So you have to establish your authority over an area before you can undertake any development. It becomes a chicken and egg story. Nitish Babu says, no, we'll undertake development first. You take development first unless you first sort of clear the area of Maoist. So Nitish Kumar had this policy. Jharkhand, complete chaos. Complete chaos until recently. Now things are taking shape. But Jharkhand, the problem was, when I went to Jharkhand, I found that everybody was taking money from Governor's Raj Bhavan down to the Thana level. Everybody is making money. All ministers are making money. Chief Minister is making money. Raj Bhavan, Governor Saab is making money. So everybody is just making money. When everybody is making money, what will happen to the state? You see, corruption, remember, corruption is one of the biggest factors. Whichever be the problem, I always say that corruption is like a thread which runs through, it is a string which runs through all the problems. So I found Jharkhand a picture of chaos. And then Shibu Seren, as long as he was the chief minister, he would say, no, we will not undertake. At one stage he gave a public statement that there will be no operations against Naxalites. If you say no operations against Naxalite, then what do we do? Of course, he was prevailed upon to retract, but the damage had been done. Now, of course, with the BJP coming, I'm told the chief minister is doing well and he's posting good officers and things are about to improve. But I said, Jharkhand had a different take. Odisha, the chief minister is a thorough gentleman. Thorough gentleman and by and large a clean person. But if you talk to him about anti-Naxal operation, bhai, ye sab, tumko jo karna ho, karo. After sunset, I must have my glass and my drinks. Koi matlab hi nahi. He is not serious about anti-Naxal operations. Whatever results were achieved, results have been achieved, but those results were achieved because you had a good director general and the police forces took a lot of initiative. So some work got done, but at the political level, there was hardly any initiative or interest in tackling the problem. They were just disinterested. Maharashtra, the problem is, it's too big a state. And the problem is concentrated in Gadchiroli district, just one district of there. So there, in Mumbai, there is no seriousness about it. So, as I said, apni apni dafli, apna apna raag, everyone is pursuing his own policy. There is no coordinated or comprehensive approach to tackling the Maoist problem. And therefore, all this is happening. Things are just drifting. Andhra Pradesh has done extremely well. Andhra Pradesh has done extremely well. And the Andhra model is recommended for other states. Andhra Pradesh has done extremely well on two counts. Firstly, they posted the best officers as district magistrate and superintendents of police in the affected areas. And these officers, at their initiative, they undertook a number of schemes to what is called WHAM. WHAM, winning hearts and minds. Winning hearts and minds of people. This was one thing. And secondly, Andhra raised a force called Greyhounds, which was very effective. And you see, wherever the Greyhounds went, the Naxals would leave the area. They didn't have the courage to face the Greyhounds. Of course, there were instances when they inflicted damage, but by and large, Greyhounds were an outfit they never felt confident about facing. So if they knew that Greyhounds are moving in this area, they would just vacate. That's a bhag chalo. Very, very good force. So very briefly, I have mentioned you, there, at the ground level, there are several other problems. Intelligence cover is very poor. Then the coordination between the central and the state forces is another gray area. Then between the states, there is always problem. So that should be enough for you. But why we are not able to make a dent on this problem? Another thing, last point which you have to remember is that there are certain socio-economic issues which need to be addressed and which have not been addressed. And therefore this problem, I mean, you may contain it at the law and order level, but the roots, the embers of discontent, those would remain. I'll mention some of those. One is land reforms. You see, land reforms, no state government is interested in. This is a state subject, and no state government is interested in this because the kulaks are there in the assembly, and they make sure that land reforms are not implemented. Even planning commission, if you read their annual reports, their 10th five-year plan report, 11th five-year plan report, they clearly say that progress in land reforms is very slow. This is one reason. Secondly, displacement of tribals. See, this has been a huge problem. See, what happens when you want to establish a steel plant, you want to have a fertilizer factory, you want to do coal mining, give coal mining contracts, you want to establish an SEZ, special economic, then land is allotted to corporate groups. You want to build a river valley project. So in the process, you acquire land in thousands of acres. And then the original inhabitants from that land are displaced. Now, these people, if you rehabilitate them, if you give them alternate sites, if you provide for their alternate employment, then it's okay. But if you just displace them and give them some token money and forget about it, then money will disappear, be spent in a few months or a few years. After that, what? How do they earn their livelihood? It is estimated that, mind you, there is no official figure, but according to an NGO, the rough estimate is that since independence, about 60 million, which means 6 crore people have been displaced like this, which is a huge number, mind you. And out of this 6 crore, 40% are tribals. Kareeb 2.5-3 crore ho gaye, tribals ho gaye. Mind you, tribal population overall is 8%. Of the total population, there are only 8%. But in this displacement, they are 40%. Now, where do these tribals go? They have nowhere to go. The Planning Commission of India prepared a report on alienation of land. And that report, one paragraph, when I read it, it's a very devastating indictment of the government. He says, I'm quoting from memory, he says the tribal has a feeling of exhaustion. He goes from door to door and there's nobody listening to him. And the feeling in his mind is that they are all conspiring to deprive him of his land at all levels. He has a feeling of complete exhaustion, that nobody is prepared to listen to me and nobody is prepared to find alternate employment for me. At that stage, what does he do? At that stage comes a Naxalite leader. Chalo, hum tumko insaaf dilayenge. So he joins the movement. He has nowhere to go. And he is angry with the government. He is angry with the total setup. At that stage, he decides to take the weapon. He decides to join the People's Liberation Guerrilla. As a member of the PLGA, when he goes to a village, he is treated with respect. By PLGA ka ye aadmi aaya, isko isko khana khilao, isko raat ko thehrne ko jagah do, warna kal ko PLGA wale aake humko maar denge. So suddenly he has acquired a social status overnight. So from being a destitute with no means of livelihood, he suddenly gets a social status. So he joins the movement. So displacement of tribals without rehabilitation, a proper rehabilitation policy was framed only in 2006. And even that has yet to be fully implemented. Before 2006, jo displaced ho gaya, wo gaya. Bhagwan bharose, jao. So these are, you see, the socio-economic factors, these have to be kept in view. Why the tribal is today alienated? Because of huge displacement of tribal population as a result of development projects taken since independence without proper relief and rehabilitation. So shall we close this subject here? You wanted police reforms. Now what do we mean by police reforms? You see, I have been pursuing this campaign of police reform for the last 18 years. Why? Because at the end of my service, I felt that it is very difficult. I mean, if you are honest and if you are committed to the country, if you are committed to the people, there are so many obstacles. Because the vested interests are so entrenched that they don't want you to enforce the rule of law in a very objective and impartial manner. They all the time they want the law to be twisted in favor of the ruling classes, the enforcement. So I said, mind you, I don't claim any copyright to all the reforms which I suggested. I went through all the police commission reports, national police commission reports, state commission reports, I mean, all the important